There was a huge buzz on the Talking Heads. In fact, Joey Ramone was the first person to tell me about them. And I went down at CB's, and I'm standing out there, and all of a sudden I hear, "When my love stands next to your love," you know, and I said, "What is this?" This music was so hypnotic. I was being sucked into the room. Then I ran up after they were over. They had no crew, they had nothing. And I helped Tina, this beautiful young girl, you know, take the stuff off the stage. I said, "You have to be on my label."
'77 is actually a landmark year for CBGB. The punk scene gets a lot of attention. Not only the local press, the New York press or the American press, but the world press came to CBGB right away. We had as many as 600 people inside CBGB for Ramon's show. Somehow, you used to see like two or three layers of people. People standing on the ground, then people standing on chairs, and people standing on the railings. So it's like, you know, the Bowery is on fire.
1977 is a seminal year. It opened up a whole new world of music to people, and it opened the eyes of an industry that needed the new Elvis. And then comes along this collection of people in this small venue, and they're creating change.
Obviously, we need more police on the streets.
Tonight, an ABC News poll shows Ed Koch and Mario Cuomo are running neck and neck among the candidates for mayor. It appears this is fast becoming a two-horse race.
How many people here are voting for Mario Cuomo? Raise your hand.
I'm staying there.
Nobody? How many people here are voting for Ed Koch?
Yay! Okay. Mario Cuomo, New York's Secretary of State, is the hand-picked candidate of the governor.
Mario Cuomo's the governor's little boy. Say it again.
Cuomo jokes about being prepared for a TV talk show.
The maker man looked at me and says, "I take this as a personal challenge."
Mario Cuomo was a young, vigorous guy from Queens who now says to Ed Koch, "He's not married. He's from Greenwich Village. So what do you think he is?"
It was during that campaign, of course, that the "Vote for Cuomo, not the Homo" flyer started appearing all over the city. Although no one ever got Ed Koch to come out publicly, even to this day. But it was the low point of homophobia in New York City politics.
It was a scurrilous campaign, and there were lots of people who believed I was gay and voted for me. Lots of people who didn't believe I was gay. Who voted for me, and most people didn't care, and my attitude was, fuck 'em.
There's been mudslinging from both the Koch and Cuomo camps, and with only weeks left until the primary, anything could happen. Good evening. Early this morning, the .44 caliber killer tried to kill again, and almost did. The killer has taunted authorities by writing two letters. Both were signed Son of Sam, one for the police, the other to Jimmy Breslin, the popular columnist for the New York Daily News.
I'm home Friday morning, and Anne Marie Caggiano from the New York Daily News, where I work, she called up to say, "We got a letter here and I don't like it. It gives me the creeps." I said, "Well, what is it?" It says, "It's from a guy, Son of Sam," she says. "Here, I'll read you. It's creepy." He says, "Hello from the gutters of the city of New York and the sidewalks with the cracks and the dried blood of the da-da-da-da-da." And I says, "Wow, that's great cadence." So they got the letter and they looked at it in the police headquarters, and sure enough, it had a fingerprint on it that matched the fingerprint they had on another letter.
The Daily News, on its front page, teased the fact that, you know, on Sunday, Jimmy Breslin is gonna come in with his column on his communication from Son of Sam. So the Daily News sort of milked it for all it's worth. And meanwhile, the New York Post is going nuts. So it was a tabloid war for the Son of Sam story, so, which certainly only heightened the city's sense of fear.
It didn't really touch my neighborhood. It didn't really come uptown. Son of Sam wasn't hanging in Harlem.
Yeah, but he didn't come to our neighborhood. That's for sure. First of all, we would have smoked his ass in a minute.
That's first thing. So we would have saved the cops. We would have saved the cops a lot of manpower.
Every neighborhood had its like neighborhood flavor. I mean, in the Bronx, in the summertime, you knew what, you know, what was happening. The sprinklers was open. Kids was playing, you know what I mean, in the street, basketball games and basketball tournaments and picnics and just like every other place, but it was in parks.
We did a lot of free parties. Echo Park, Arthur Park, 183rd Street Park.
One particular day, we were playing, myself and my DJ partner, Disco Wiz, out in the park in the Bronx.
Cash and I were challenged to a battle, to a street DJ battle. Just like any other day, we were at 183rd Street in the park between Valentine and Raya. So we kind of hotwired the street like, you know, like we always did, and got the juice, got the party going and everything.
So we come on, right? So we ready, you know what I mean, to put the turntable. Got my records ready. I put the first record on, and I know that as soon as people hear this, they're going to go wild. So boom. Energy is flowing. Record is going, right? I grab the next record. I bring it in. Lights start going out. The street lights along the street start going out. One at a time, like in a row. Poof, poof, poof.
We just looked at each other. Wow, did we do this? I mean, because we were jacked up to a street lamp, you know what I mean?
I was home, sitting here watching television. Bingo. All the lights go off, television goes off. I go up to the roof, look out. Darkness.
I'm 12 years old. I'm watching Bewitched on television. And boom, the lights go out. I thought it was just us, because that's a common occurrence. I looked outside, and everything was black.
On the night of the blackout, my friend Cheech was visiting. Cheech from Cheech and Chong, you know. And I got a call. Well, the lights went out. I said, come on, let's go up to the Bronx. Okay. I'm covering the story.
Oh, I was in the middle of a blowjob with a client at Caesar's Retreat, and all the power went out.
It was July 13th, 1977. New York was at the beginning of what would become a brutal 10-day heat wave where temperatures were daily over 100.
Con Ed says the blackout was triggered when severe lightning knocked out transmission lines that connected Indian Point, the state's main power grid, to the city. With those lines down and with demand for power unusually high because of a heat wave, other generating plants, unable to handle the load, began cutting themselves off. It took only minutes before it was all over. New York had been disconnected from the nation's electric system.
The first reality check was a bodega right across the street from where we were playing. The gate went down.
Shoom! Shoom! Shoom!
All pandemonium broke, and people just started screaming blackout. And then you heard, like, bottles breaking and people just running. And we were, like, stuck out there with all this equipment. And to be out there in the blackout, you were prime. You know what I mean? You were prime for the picking.
Everybody was like, hit the stores. It was like, hit the stores! And everybody just started running all at once. Started running towards us. Me and Wiz, we had other ideas, okay? We pull out the guns, we like, no, no, run that way, okay? Don't run this way, run that way. Wiz stayed with the equipment, and I proceeded around the corner because there was an electronics store, the Sound Room, and they had DJ equipment in there. And this is my first time admitting this, telling this story, but
Yes, I did sneak in there, help crash the gate down, and crawl in and pull out a Clubman 2 mixer. But like I said, couldn't just say I'm gonna be a DJ. You needed equipment. And that's all I really, you know, wanted. I wasn't trying to loot, you know, everything I could find.
Before that blackout, you know, we had literally just maybe four or five legitimate DJ crews. The next day, the very next day, it sprung this whole revolution of DJs. That was a huge spark and a huge contribution to the hip-hop culture.
The rest of the city had other things on their mind. Supermarkets, department stores, banks, check cashing places, jewelry stores, everything.
The morale in the police department was very low because there had been layoffs and pay freezes. So when they got the call to start showing up for work the night of the blackout, a lot of them were not inclined to do so.
Now guys are starting to come in. We're all in uniform, we're all sitting around. And the door flies open. And this guy comes in. What the F is going on? They're walking away with my store. The CO hears this and he comes out and he says, who are you? He says, I'm the commanding officer. You're the commanding officer? Well, command something. He says, they're walking away with Broadway.